Welcome to another edition of SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always. Just to peel back behind the curtain, this is the first podcast I'm recording in 2021. This is the 1st of January. My guest has been very kind to possibly not have a couple of drinks last night and is wide awake and ready to go for our first show of 2021. So this is like February now to those that are actually listening. I am joined this week by a veteran in British wrestling, Shady Nattrass. Welcome to the show.
Okay, pleased to be on. Hope you enjoyed your new year.
It was very quiet. that was about it. I've got a dog, so we're always afraid of fireworks, but thankfully there's only one or two idiots out doing that this year. For those that are watching the video feed for the first time, you'll see that I'm actually on like a host side of the screen because I didn't know you could just drag the thing over. So before I just felt weird being on the other side, thinking, oh, I look like the guest. But anyway, this is all not important stuff. Thank you for joining me. First question is always, how did you get into pro wrestling?
I probably became a fan in 92. And it was, you know what I mean, most people didn't really have Sky back then. So there was the WCW on ITV in the middle of the night on the, I think it was a Saturday night maybe. That just kind of snowballed from there. I got into watching your WWF stuff. And then by 99, myself and my three brothers all kind of, we found a school and was like dive in there rather than fighting each other in our house.
So 92, so that would have been, well, 92 WCW, I've very little information on that on the top of my head, but 92 WWF I'm more in tune with. So who are your favourites growing up then?
I liked people like Mr. Perfect and My Ginetti and more like faster paced or wrestlers rather than your Hulk Hogan's and people like that. But yeah, as I said, I didn't really follow the glitz and glamour at the top of the card. I always liked the proper wrestling matches.
Yeah, like your intercontinental title level. Because that was the well known as being like the workhorse title. That was the one, that's where your wrestlers were and your showmen were at the top of the card, selling the tickets, the wrestlers in the Intercontinental title picture were actually providing the show kind of thing. Okay, so 1999, so that's probably bang in the middle of that age era. Was that kind of your push forward into actually going to train, or was it just a case of you've destroyed enough things in the house, you've got to go and get out your system somewhere else?
By 99, we'd kind of started accumulating the start of our VHS tape collection, and we'd started getting our independent shows and Japanese shows, and we were kind of fully emerged in the wrestling business by that point. We were just desperate to get started, and we found in a magazine there was a wrestling school in Blackpool, and it was like the one we had heard of was Hammerlock, and that was all the way down in Kent. So Kent to Carlisle was a bit too long distance for us, but Blackpool was accessible enough for us. So we dived in there and kind of got a bit fleeced, to be honest. But it was it got us started.
My geography is absolutely awful, but how far away would Blackpool be from Carlisle?
About an hour and a half.
All right. Okay. Yes. So that's in this in my own head. Then that's here to Aberdeen. Then so that's more than doable then for training. So you said you felt a bit fleeced. Was it very very basic, or was it even less than basic training you got?
Less than that. We paid £200 signing up fee, which we'd read about schools in America, and they often had a signing up fee. So we weren't too put out by that, but we turned up and it was in a boxing ring. I think the lessons were an hour and a half and it was £20 a lesson. And after about 5 or 6 weeks, he pretty much just ended up opening the door, letting us in, use the ring, and then he'd come back and lock up.
Wow. Okay. So, and that first 5 weeks then was pretty much just bump. And that was about it. And then just go, right, figure out yourself.
Yeah. Learned the basics, and that was pretty much it. Yeah.
So, how was it like going from, I mean, I know, well, you said you and your brothers all destroyed everything. I was the same, but I was like me and my mates in school gardens, whatever we could grass mainly. So what was it like going from the gardens, the in the house, to actually taking your first bump?
It wasn't too bad because my two older brothers had done judo for years, so I kind of had an idea about break falls and landing, but it was, yeah, it wasn't too bad, but I feel them more now when I wrestle rather than back then.
So 1989, so when did you actually have your first match?
It was 2001, because okay. When we went, it got to a point after I don't know how long, where we turned up for the training and he just wasn't there. So that was the end of that. And then we moved on to what was called GBH at the time, and that was down in Stoke. And that's like a 3-hour drive. Okay. And that was, say, 5 hours training on mats. We did an occasional day where we'd use the ring. And yeah, that was where we had our first match. It was for them, and that was interesting, shall we say, because we still didn't know how well the matches were to be worked, if you know what I mean. We kind of got told, hey, you're having this match, there you go. So we didn't know about match times and things like that, which, like, when I know at Target, when we have training, we kind of teach our trainees about, okay, you should be aiming for, I don't know, 10 minutes or whatever. So at least you have an idea. But yeah, we just kind of got thrown in the deep end, and here, have your match.
But, so was that in front of a crowd, or was it just my friends and family kind of thing?
From anyone. It was, because we had the match. And as I say, normally the promoter would tell you how long your match was to be on for. And we didn't get any of that. So, yeah, it was interesting, but we made it through all safe and got started. So got the ball rolling.
So we went from there, and I just went on cage match very quickly yesterday and thought, right, I'll write down some of the names that you've faced over the years, and we'll try and pick out a couple of them as we go. And then my list just kept getting bigger and bigger. So just off top, for anyone listening, I had Al Snow, Chris Sabin, Paul London, Killian Dane, Petey Williams, Paul Birchall, Doug Williams, Jody Fleisch, Johnny Storm, Angelico, Ricochet, Kaylee Ray, Jeff Cobb, Roderick Strong.
Yep.
There's a ton more that I have not mentioned. Jay Lethal was I've actually got a separate note, which we'll get to. But I also noticed that you also had a lot of tag team matches, yeah, as far back as cage match went, which was, yeah, 2003, I think, was your first match, according to the Germans. Yeah. Was part of the Nattrass boys. So I'm sure, yeah, I was one of your brothers, Jay Nattrass. So how was it like teaming with your brother, or was that kind of like the dream, like Edge and Christian was your dream, always win tag team titles? Was that always a kind of thought in the back of your mind?
Well, because there was the three of us trained. There was myself, my brother Jay, and my brother XL. And it, depending on what company we're in, we kind of rotated. as to who was the singles wrestler and who was tagging. So there'd be times where I'd be tagging with Jay and XL would be having a singles run, or there'd be times when I'd be on my own and it would be Jay and XL tagging. So yeah, it was all just, we just wanted to wrestle. We didn't really plan that far ahead. It was, British wrestling was still in a dark day. It was still not such a big scene as it is now. So it was a case of, let's just see where we can go.
Were you ever pulled in on the tribute shows? Were you not part of the American wrestling tribute?
I'm trying to think
any of the names of them, but Degenerate X and stuff like that. And
I think we did one show with the UK Undertaker, and that was an all-star show. And I think that was the only one that we've done.
I've only ever heard the name UK Undertaker. I've never actually seen what UK Undertaker looks like at this stage. So, did he look anything like Undertaker, or am I just a guy with long hair?
Well, to put it into current terms, it would be like if you ordered Undertaker from Wish.
Ah, okay, I'm with you. That's fine. All right, so out of that list of guys, are just of all the big American names you faced, who was your first one, if you remember?
And the first one I faced was Pete Williams, and that was for WZW. Other than the northeast of England.
So when about would that have been?
2005, I think that was.
Oh, so this was peak like TNA. This was Pete Williams as well. So did you end up taking him to KA Destroyer?
Yeah, of course I did.
Of course, yeah. Of course.
It's one of my favourite moves to take. I'm a big fan of taking that move. So I'll anytime I can. Bring that into a match, I'm more than happy to.
So what was it like going into the ring with someone like, well, like say 2005, TNA were doing big business in there, the wrestling channel and everything on that's when I was watching it. So what was it like going in the ring with someone of an international reputation and talent like Pete Williams?
To be honest, it was pretty nerve-wracking. I often put a lot of pressure on myself at the best of times just because I want to do a good job. But yeah, the extra pressure of it being an international name added to it. But yeah, it was fun. It was a good little match, I think. Especially for the time, I think we did everything we needed to do.
Excellent. So did you find? Were you one of the founders of Target Wrestling? Was that something that?
Yeah. Well, it's my brother's in charge of it, Jay, and that came from we were running shows as Triple Team Promotions, and then we kind of progressed that into Target Wrestling, and kind of got a rebrand and a bit of a push there.
That makes sense now, because I saw a lot of triple team promotions before, and then it just became Target when I was looking through the old cage match. So, like I said, going through this list of people that you've faced, we'll get back to Target. And this podcast just jumps all over the place, but we'll get back there. Along with your Pro Wrestling Is Real Life series as well. One of the names that you bring up quite a lot on Twitter as being one of your favourite opponents is Paul London. Which would have been in Target Wrestling as well. So what was it like going, again, meeting Paul, and he's got his big reputation just for just being nice. So what was it like facing Paul and just his relationship with yourself and Target?
Paul's genuinely one of my best friends now. And that's like, you know what I mean, for somebody that's born and raised in Carlisle, wrestling fan for so long, to have that's pretty cool for me. And as far as the match, about say 2 weeks beforehand, I had suffered badly from glandular fever, and I was like bedridden for days with stupidly high fever. When we started the match, I took I think he did like a baseball slide, and I'm lying on the floor on the outside of the ring, my chest's on fire, and like it's going through my head. I'm thinking, I can't finish this. But we kept going, and then he did a slingshot Oklahoma roll and drove his shoulder into my elbow, and I thought I had broke my arm. So it was a fun-filled match, and I was able to carry on, and it just kind of settled, and we just finished it, and I think the chemistry between us just was off the charts. Like he cut a promo afterwards, and like to be honest, I was nearly in tears. He was just, yeah, I kind of thought, I kind of get wrestling a bit more now, which that was like 14 years in.
So it's one of those things where you just learn every day. I mean, like I say, I'm from the outside looking in, and I'm still finding things out and I'm not even actually doing the wrestling. I'm just speaking about it, which is often safer, I would think. So Paul London, another one that you've mentioned that you would love to face again would be Chris Sabin. I mean, a lot of the guys, these names that I'm picking out here, they've done amazingly, but a lot of TNA names like Chris Sabin, like Doug Williams, he had a good run TNA, and Roderick Strong as well, be another. Were you a big TNA fan round about then as well? And was this kind of just mind blowing to think you were facing these guys?
Well, yeah, like I kind of just followed any good wrestling, and yeah, TNA and Ring of Honor as well. I kind of had a little run where it seemed like I was facing a few that had worked there. A Lucha Underground, I had a few from Lucha Underground, which kind of, it did seem to follow, hey, I'm enjoying watching these wrestling matches from a certain company, and then the matches would fall into place. But yeah, Sabin, we had a really good chemistry, myself and Sabin, and Carbon was in the match as well, and I just think if I could get a singles match with him, that would be very enjoyable.
Yeah, I mean, what's that, 14 years? That was 2000, was whatever it was, 2013, would that be, your years? So, about 20 years now, you've been wrestling, and sure. what have you seen change in the industry as a whole? Because when you said dark days is when you started, and then you would have went through the peak, which would have been, 2014, 15, and it's kind of leveled off a little bit. So what changes have you seen, be it training, be it camaraderie, be it the wrestling in general, over those years?
The standards all around have improved, from the wrestling to the way shows are run. Back in the early days, you wouldn't get shows with first aiders. It's just the standards all around have improved greatly, and the training, I know, as I say, I can only really speak for the training at Target, but it goes from like the days when we were taught literally the basics to we try to go as in-depth as possible. So we don't have our trainees going in and not knowing what to do in certain circumstances. You have to be able to adapt, and if you're only taught one thing, you only know one way to go. So, the more information people have, then hopefully the better people can be.
Yeah, that's definitely important, especially this level, the year just passed as well. Information and even transparency is probably the most important thing that needs to happen, or at least be promoted, which I haven't heard a bad word about Target. I mean, Stephen Louch, who I've had on before, he's pretty much he's pretty much where I get my Target info and passion from, because I hear him just going on about these shows. I'm just thinking, well, they must be doing pretty well, because he's coming all the way down from from wherever to actually to come to the shows. So it must be worth coming especially back to.
Polo promotions were a big reason for Target's success, I think. So when Stephen Louch started heading down, it was primarily to see the polos, but then I don't think he kind of realised what the atmosphere was going to be like.
How would you describe the atmosphere of Target then? What would be its audience, that you the core audience for it?
Well, you get a good mix at Target, because you'll get a lot of families there, but you'll also get a lot of, say, 20-something-year-olds, even 30-year-olds that are going and basically using it as a pre-night out drinks. And they'll have a few drinks, watch the wrestling. And because we're based pretty much in the centre of Carlisle, they head out afterwards and have more drinks afterwards. So it's a good mix of family and over 18s. So it's good.
Great. I mean, that's from the bits and pieces I've seen on YouTube. I've watched some matches and shows where I can, because I think some of them went on to Fight, didn't they? Fight TV.
Yes,
thank you. The audience, I know they came about later, but the audience I could compare it to is like Discovery, where it is kind of that there is kids about, but it's like a teen into adult audience as well. So there's no, everyone's having a good time, but nobody's paying for blood and swearing and just going a bit rowdy and stuff like that. They kind of keep it. They're a wrestling crowd. They're coming to see wrestling. They're not coming to
absolutely,
make themselves
absolutely.
The show.
And I think that's why I enjoy it at Discovery so much. I think I fit well in there because it's the same sort of atmosphere. So I very much think it's very similar to Discovery.
I've written down Discovery as one of my notes, because of course you have made quite a few appearances over the years in Discovery. So you've been, you've been everywhere, but you've been in quite a few companies over the years. Is there any that stand out as being particular ones that you'd want to either go back to or continue to work with, be it the crowd or the setup?
Discovery, I actually tweeted out the other day that I'd love to grow to be main eventer at Discovery. I think I could get over quite well. I'm quite disliked up there, so I think it would work quite well.
So when you actually started, what was it like having to play to the crowd? Because of course, I mean, your only prior experience would have been you and your brothers beating each other up, with them being also judo background. I'm assuming you got thrown around a lot. So of course, taking it from that, going just playing about and throwing yourself about to actually going in front of a crowd, was there a lot of nerves to be yourself or just be the turned up or a different character? What was it like?
It was pretty nerve-wracking, but at the same time, we were aware we had to do some of it, if you know what I mean. We had to work the crowd. We had to get the crowd on our side, or in if we were heels or faces. It still took a long time before I kind of realised that was the priority. The wrestling often comes second. After I worked that match with Paul London, and I eventually turned heel. Once that happened, I kind of realised the good matches then follow. I had spent a long time trying to have good matches, and then you realise, or if I concentrate on the fans will get into it, the good match follows.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of a strange way of thinking about it, but that's how it seemed to work.
No, absolutely. I mean, when you break it down, when you think about, say, Hulk Hogan matches or what have you, if you watch them on mute or with no crowd, They're awful. they're not good. They're just nothing. But when you have the electricity of a crowd, that's why now with like WWE and their Thunderdome and what have you, it's so weird to watch it without a crowd because they don't have anyone to feed off of. So they're just assuming what they're doing is correct, which really separates the men from the boys when you can clearly see that as well. So yeah, you're very much disliked at Target. You've even got the nice t-shirt saying "I hate wrestling fans," which hits nail on the head very well. So do you find it that role a lot more comfortable as opposed to coming out and clapping your hands, going "Come on, guys!" You could just kind of just not ignore them, but let them in, but ignore them.
It's a lot more natural. My general appearance, my face will look pretty miserable, even if I'm happy. So if I'm going out there and I'm getting booed, it looks like I'm really not enjoying myself, and then that obviously gets the fans more into it. So yeah, it's rather easier for me to be a heel than a face, but it's fun.
I think the term, because I have the exact same issue, is resting bitch face. And I just, I look at pictures in the past or even recently and I go, I was smiling in that picture. My face does not say that at all. I look miserable as sin. So you've done quite well in Target. As for my research goes, triple crown winner. You won the heavyweight, the high octane, the tag team championships as well. So pop Target aside, so triple crown winner of that. Let's go to what you're doing just now, because there's no wrestling happening. And when this goes out in February, I'm still pretty certain there'll be no wrestling happening. So a couple of things you've done. We've got three bullet points here. We'll start with Pro Wrestling Unity. So of course, which I am sporting the t-shirt of during this little podcast. Of course, everything went away in June when speaking out happened. So we won't delve too much into speaking out because, you know, it's a sad subject and we want to keep this kind of upbeat. And then Pro Wrestling Unity kind of came from there. So what was the reasons behind it beginning? Let's talk about that.
Well, initially, I had the idea before speaking out came around, because I know when I've been sharing posts and if I have a highlight video or an upcoming match graphic, you can only share so much of your own stuff. And I like to, if I see like one of my friends has a highlight video, I'll share that. And the idea behind Wrestling Unity was help get more eyes on everybody, and then obviously when speaking out happened, I kind of felt that we needed more help to show that there is still good in the business, and it, as I say, it literally takes a second for somebody to retweet or share somebody's anything, whether it's a wrestler or a promotion or a podcast or merchandise. It's the more people that we can help, the better. Yes, we do sell t-shirts, but that's secondary to our aim. Our aim is to kind of just help as much of wrestling as we can.
Kind of breed some positivity. Because, I mean, I've got a t-shirt store, if anyone wants to go check that out. But yeah, again, that is, I'm the exact same boat. It is secondary. What we do is just promote Scottish wrestling. So we're similar in that respect, where we just want to just put out some good stuff and good news. Yeah. And because the more that people, more eyes on anything means that people get their merch sold, they buy tickets to the next show because they saw that guy on Twitter, and it all works. That's how it's supposed to work.
And it's not just one of the issues that you'll find is you'll get wrestling fans see wrestling things, and sometimes it's the general public that's a better audience. They're the ones that we need to bring in. So say somebody else that isn't a wrestling fan that follows you on Twitter and sees you share something, you've potentially got a new customer, whether it's to the show or whatever. So yeah, the more people, wrestling fans or general public, see stuff, the bigger and better wrestling can be.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what social media should be used for, not just the old negative stuff, which just goes through our timelines every day. But speaking of positivity, though, you're also offering feedback. I mean, 20 years in wrestling, you must have some thoughts on how to do it, because, of course, you're still doing it after 20 years. So you're offering feedback to wrestlers just to give them a little bit of tips and hints and tips and pointers. Again, was that just because of lockdown, nothing to do? You thought, oh, I'll just pass on some
wisdom. I love teaching wrestling. I like to think that I can help people see things that others can't, because I've had various wrestlers point things out to me. Just maybe say I work a match with a top name, they might put something to me that's a different point of view that I hadn't thought of. But then a month later, I could work with somebody with a different style who will see something different again. So I think because of the range of wrestlers that I've worked with, I've kind of picked up a lot of little things that often get overlooked. And you know, like, I still want my work critiqued. Every wrestler should be wanting to improve. And if your trainer doesn't point something out, it doesn't mean that it's not an issue. It's just your trainer hasn't noticed it or isn't aware of it himself. So the more people can kind of give you ideas, the better you can kind of even mentally prepare yourself to possibly improve. I always tell the people that I've done it with, they can take away whatever it is they want from what I've given them, because you're not always going to agree. I know I've had feedback from a wrestler watching one of my matches, and to be honest, we didn't agree with what he said, but we just kind of went, thank you, and took it on board. Didn't really agree with it, but it's now there. It's now, okay, well, what if we did do that? It gives more ideas to what you can do. So yeah, it's fun for me to help people. So yeah, I just want to help.
I mean, pro wrestling, like you say, you're pretty much saying it's subjective. I mean, I could watch, someone could watch a match where they think it's the best match ever, and I'll watch it and go, but I mean, when I do reviews, when I was doing reviews, when there was shows actually to watch, I would always try and make it as constructive. If I was going to say something, oh, I didn't like this, but I mean, I'm just a spectator for it, but like, I watched some guys in UPW when they came up this end, Bucky and all that kind of places. Yeah. And there was a guy, I'll just say his name because he doesn't wrestle anymore, but it was Chris Lamb. And the first few times I watched him, he was hunched. And all I said in my reviews was, if he pulls his shoulders up, that's it. That's all you need. Last match I saw him, pulled his shoulders were up. He looked like a wrestler at that point. And then the show, then the actual promotion went away and he stopped wrestling. So we waste time at that point. But it was just like, that's it. Just one little thing. Just
a little bit of detail, and that can make a big difference.
Exactly. I mean, when you go out to wrestle, you're in front of everyone. You're in front of kids who just want to see some wrestling. You're in front of adults who may have just taken their kids. And then you're in front of of me who watches too much wrestling and likes details and likes little logics, likes little stories and logic. And if you went out there and the first thing you did was kick the guy in the knee, I'm expecting you to work that knee. So that's just my little thing when I watch shows. But yeah, speaking about your, I went through that list and like I say, variety, Doug Williams, technical wrestler. He'll try and twist and turn you and work on and joints and what have you. Then Angelico, who will dive at you. So you've definitely got a fair roster of brains that you've been able to pick up, pick apart over the years. Is that pretty much what you do when you get these guys? So you just after the match, just go, right, what can I do? What did we do there?
And it's kind of being able to evolve your character to work with them. I like to think that my character's going to get over and the wrestling will fit. So it'll look like, say, an Helico match, but you'll be more than aware that it's a Shady match as well. So it's trying to kind of, my thing that I like to do is try and still fit it into a Shady match, because you'll find a lot of imports, you'll go, okay, well, he's going to have, as I say somebody like Angelico, we know what we're going to get from his match. But if you get your own character over as well, it kind of helps, as like I said earlier, it helps the match improve because both people are going to look good. So, yeah, it's trying to kind of pick how I can fit my character in with these big names. And, yeah, I kind of think it's worked so far.
And you're the guy that's coming back. So you've got to, if someone goes to the show and sees an Helico match with you and it's all flippy-doos and everything, and then they go, right, I need to say that Shady guy next month, and go back and you're not doing any of that. They'll be like, oh, well,
my biggest problem I had with my Al Snow match. Well, first of all, Al Snow was like my favorite wrestler by the late 90s. I was a massive Al Snow fan, so I was already like well nervous hearing the stories about him as well and how he was on Tough Enough and things. As when it came to planning the match, he said, you can call any move you want in the ring. We might not do it. No pressure. So then at the time I was a face and we got in the ring, and then the ref had went to Al and he came over, the ref came back to me and the ref says, he says you're a heel now. And I kind of went, oh, how am I going to do this? Because I've got to come back next month as the baby face. So it worked. I just kind of tweaked what I was doing and made myself a bit more aggressive rather than cheating. But yeah, we got it to work. But
that's a bit of a weird one, especially that. I mean, that should. I mean, we won't say anything bad about Arsenal because, yeah, it is a terrifying human. But, it's that. Yeah, you got to think. If you're the guy that's coming back, then you got to kind of stick with what you're doing. That's weird. Speaking of that roster again, Kaylee Ray being one of the matches you've had. We're not going to go for, the whole gender thing, but did you have to mix up any of your style? Did you have to do anything differently because you're facing Kaylee, because she's one of the best anyway. So
it was an easy match. It was fun. It was good. There was no the whole intergender thing is only an issue if you make it an issue. It wasn't really much different to a normal one of my matches.
Absolutely. Cool. We've got Jay Lethal there. We'll go to Jay Lethal because that's quite a big one, because you faced him for the Ring of Honor heavyweight championship or world heavyweight championship. Again, we spoke about your being anxious about going into matches with Sabin and Paul London because these are guys that are just guys you've watched. But the fact that you're going in with Jay Lethal with a title on the line that a company that you watched when you were growing up, how weird was that? And again, how did you get through it?
It was very weird. It's where I want to be. I want to be at that level where I do get in a position with people that good. Luckily, there was no major nerves anywhere. We actually worked as a title versus title match. It all worked really well. Apart from what we had planned for the finish, Jay actually threw one of the titles out the ring, which we were going to be used for the finish. So it was meant to be in place in the ring. And he was like, I've thrown the belt out. Luckily, we had the second belt we could use and kind of on the fly, just quickly put that into play as if we meant to do it the whole time.
Well, that's the best thing about wrestling is, again, we've said it's subject and all that, but it is a performance art at the end of the day. So you can make tweaks and changes mid-match. It's not a set script. You're not like going out beforehand and going, right, here's my list of moves I have to do in this order and I cannot change it from there. Do you ever find that, do you ever have that moment where you're in there and going, I got nothing, and just blank, or have you done that long now, it's just kind of a bit second nature to you?
It's kind of second nature to us, and luckily I've kind of fine-tuned what I do, so I'm kind of already, I know where I've got to be, what I've got to do. If you watch one of my matches, I'm not always a big move doer. I have my handful of moves, and the rest we kind of work together to raise the match rather than do all the cool moves. We'll still add the cool moves in when we need to, but yeah, it's luckily I've kind of, as I say, fine-tuned what I need to do.
I mean, that's the key for still doing it after 20 years, I suppose. It's kind of keeping it safe and having a nice series of moves you know you can do really well. And do them really well. Have you been fairly injury free, or has it had any knocks or scrapes along the way?
I'm pretty much held together by tape these days. Both my shoulders are pretty banged up, and like rotator cuff injuries, and both my ankles have very little ligaments left in them. Back aches every day. In real life, I've got three kids as well, so keeping up is pretty hard work nowadays.
Here's me sitting here thinking, oh, I'll never do wrestling because I broke my elbow in three places and it doesn't sit right. I'm thinking, you know, when I hear that, maybe it's not that bad in second thoughts. So we'll move on to your pro wrestling is real life. So again, lockdown's happened. Nothing's happening. You're giving feedback to wrestlers. You're promoting positivity through pro wrestling unity. So with three kids as well, you think, right, what else can I do? YouTube series. So again, it was just kind of going through your old matches and just thinking, oh, I can do something with this, or just keep yourself busy. What was your thought behind that?
It was a way of sharing my previous matches, but done in a way that wasn't just a case of me posting a link. Hey, this is the match that I've shared 6 months ago. It's trying to add a little bit extra to it. A little bit of talking beforehand, and then afterwards I kind of try and add a little plug for somebody that's, as I say, the same thing that I do with Pro Wrestling Unity. It's just trying, as I say, trying to help people where I can. it's just a fresh way of putting out old footage, really.
I mean, there's some matches through there that, like Iceman, which is a name that may not have heard of for a very long time, against names I've heard of just in passing. But you've got a fair, I mean, aside back that list, you've got a back catalogue a mile long of wrestlers from abroad and from the UK I'm sure you've got some sort of footage of, whether it be in a very grainy Nokia camera or something a bit more high def now. What would be your maybe not one favourite match, because again, huge list, but who would be your favourite opponents that you've had, say, if I don't know, five or something like that, over the years?
Paul London, as I say, kind of changed how I seen wrestling. And the second match that we had, when he was a mystery opponent, and the reaction he got when he came out, and then he beat me for the High Octane title, was the reaction was off the chart. And we'd been telling the story over months, my whole High Octane title reign, I'd win by, I got DQ'd, so I kept the title, or the ref would take a bump, and then I'd hit my opponent with the belt and then get a cheap finish. But by the time it came to the match with Paul, I tried all the old tactics and they never worked. So then he finally got the win. People kind of went a bit insane for it. So it was, we couldn't have asked for a better reaction.
That's the kind of long-term storytelling I like, because I mean, I watch WrestleZone up here. That's my whole promotion, and they have that kind of thing. They reward, like Target does, they reward past people that come, past crowds, to give that massive reaction. Is that on YouTube, possibly, that I could go check that out?
It will be.
I'll keep an eye out for the Pro Wrestling Real Life series. Anyway, so Paul London, one of your opponents. Who else?
Shane Strickland. Isaiah Swerve Scott, as he's in NXT now. We just had a great chemistry. It just kind of worked. And then the match that we had was a lot of fun. I don't think a lot of the Target audience at the time knew who he was. So to then see him and us have this match, people kind of went, oh yeah, we need to keep an eye on him. So yeah, I enjoyed that. I'd also say Chris Sabin, as I said before. I thought we had a really good chemistry. I'd say Josh Terry. He's one of my favourite opponents. I think we work really well, him being a clean-cut babyface with all the fancy moves, going against my straight, miserable character. that's always a match I enjoy. I'd also say maybe Jeff Cobb. Jeff Cobb was a really easy match, it was just, other than getting thrown across the ring, it was fun.
I was about to say, the first four that you gave me were all high flyers, so you'd end up, you were the base for them, for lack of a better term. Yeah. So you're able to, you were throwing them about, and then you throw in Jeff Cobb right at the end. So, you like wrestling, you just like wrestling, but do you find working with guys that are high flyers, like your Paul London, that you just find that suits opposing you a bit better than facing a big guy who could throw you about?
I enjoy, as you say, being the base, and that's the kind of style that if it was up to me, just enjoying my matches rather than putting on a show, it would probably be them sort of matches that I'd be doing. But as I said, Jeff Cobb, I didn't quite realise how strong he was until we were in the match.
He is a beast of a man, just from watching on TV, just incredible. So again, with Target, there's been quite a lot of, I get, like this is the list of names that you face, but it'd be guys like Abyss coming through Target and that. So you said your brother Jay runs it, who's one of the owners for it. So do you kind of come together and think these are guys that Target would like to see, or is it a case of just finding guys for your guys to face? What's the thoughts that go into booking these
talents? It's a bit of everything. It's a bit of, okay, well, who would people want to see? Who's available? Because sometimes it is just a case of this wrestler's in the country. Why not get him on our show as well? And as you say, like, who'll go well with one of our guys? So, yeah, like, some of our trainees have gone up with Too Cool, Raven, Blue Meanie, and all done really well. MJF even was on with a couple of our lads. So, yeah, they've all kind of done their part when they've been given the big matches. So, we're very proud of the trainees that have come through.
Well, that's a perfect segue to one of the fan questions I got was from, I do not know how to begin to pronounce that name, Kair Luel. Apologise if I got that wrong. it's a question for Shady Nattrass on the podcast. Yeah, that's fine. Being a mainstay in Target Wrestling, is there any young wrestlers or trainees that he feels could make an impact on the British wrestling scene in 2021?
The three standout ones at Target are Chris Kendall, Luke Ross, and Owen Michaels. I think them three could have a big year next year. Totally different. Each of them have their own style, but yeah, I think they'll all have big years this year. We're in 21 now.
I know, it's just, it'll take a couple of days to get used to it, I'm sure. By the time we get used to it, it'll be 2022, because we'll probably still be... I'll still be in quarantine. I when I first started covering Target for, I did the results for Wrestle Ropes, and then eventually I do your Scottish shows. So because you're right on that border, Carlisle. So I'll pick up Lockerbie and Dumfries and that for our site. I love that Chris Kendall and I've totally blanked his name there. You just said it, but I love that their tag team name is Chris Cross. And I was not old enough to be there for Criss Cross, but all I've got in my head. Did they come out to jump?
No, luckily they never. I think it went over a few people's heads, including my head.
I never actually saw wrestle, but as soon as I saw the name, I thought, oh, I think I had to jump. I might love a tag team I've never seen with that, just that alone. So is there anyone else in the UK that you find that's kind of caught your eye? I mean, you did the feedback for a lot of guys, like is it Ian Skinner, I think you did as well, yeah. Omar Muhammad. So is there any guys that you've, or girls, of course, inclusive, that you've spotted that think, well, they might make something of themselves this year or next?
Yeah, I think Ian Skinner could have a good year. As I say, it kind of depends how our shows get back onto being allowed to run. If we can get some shows in the UK and these wrestlers can get a few matches under the belt, I think they'll keep progressing really well.
And as far as opponents, I mean, you did a couple of lists on Twitter, I saw. Is there any opponents that you particularly want to get in the ring with once shows return in this year or next?
I finally want to get in the ring with Sha Samuels. I think that one would go down well in their Target. Yeah.
Have you seen him at the moment with his weight loss and trimming?
Yeah, he's looking good.
He's ridiculous. I mean, is moonsault's not going to look as terrifying at this rate? He'll float away. It's just looking incredible. But so Sha, I've only had the pleasure of seeing Sha wrestle twice. I was about to say once, but I've actually seen him twice. Yeah, he's one of those big, loud characters, and I think if he comes against you, you're sully, grim-faced, just surly. That's the word, not sully. That's a character in Monsters, Inc. Surly, a character. I think it would work quite well from that. I don't know why I had in my head, if you faced Rampage Brown, or I know he's come through Target before.
I have worked Rampage a couple of times at Target.
Is he one of those like Jeff Cobb you enjoyed but you'd rather not get thrown about?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah, Rampage is awesome, and I know a lot of people are negative about NXT UK, but I think it's good for him that he's got in there.
So he seems like a guy who would fit there. My only issue, I mean, he said a lot of negative things about NXT UK. My only issue, it needs characters. It's got great wrestlers, but it doesn't have characters. So, my top of my head, again, Target Wrestling, former Target Wrestling champion, Grado. That's my example that comes to the top of my head. Not the best wrestler, he'll say himself, but he's a fantastic character. So that's what NXT UK needs. It needs someone to go, right, I'm here to entertain you. I'm not here to do all this British wrestling stuff.
It's all well and good having 5 matches of 10 good wrestlers, but if they're all essentially the same good wrestler, no one stands out. Just by being good isn't always enough. So yeah, you kind of need to, as you say, need to stand out a bit.
Absolutely. I mean, I think World of Sport Wrestling had it right for the characters they had, but they just did not shoot the show as a wrestling show. But they don't know how to, because we're watching Britain's Got Talent and they don't know how to shoot dancers. So what a chance are they going to have doing wrestling if they can't show dancers dancing properly? It just blows my mind. But yeah, so we've covered a little bit here. I'm sure that if we started going through again this list, this long list of names, we'd have about a few hours of stories. But is there any that spring to mind, any opponents that are particular highlight matches? I mean, you said Paul London and Shane Strickland, but any matches that you went in thinking, oh, I'm not sure how this is going to go, and it came out either worse than you imagined or incredible?
One match which kind of could have went either way was a four-way between myself, Carbon, Wild Boar and Mike Bailey. And it just seemed to work really well, and people reacted because we did some fairly silly four-way fast-paced spots with lots of dives and Mike Bailey's brutal kicks and Wild Boar being the animal he is. Yeah, it ended up working really well.
I was going to say, when you read that, when you said that out loud, I was like, that's a mix and a half, just from that, the names that you put out there. So sometimes that actually makes wrestling the better, when it is so different. When you go in with, I mean, I was going to say a high flyer against a massive guy like a Creator or something like that, but I mean, that's just wrestling, that's David versus Goliath. But when that stuff like that, quite a mix, quite an eclectic mix there. So what are your goals coming into this year, because you know it's not going to happen, but next year, NXT UK, touring Europe, getting to America, what would be your goals?
Yeah, I kind of want to just get as far as possible. You know what I mean? I love wrestling. If I get any opportunities, I can get wrestling out. I want to be doing them, whether it's, as you say, NXT UK or traveling anywhere. I'm all for any new companies and things. And hopefully by this time, we've got some shows lined up, because on paper, I've already got some new companies lined up that I'm going to be working for. So hopefully shows are back up and running again. And hopefully by then we've been announced as well. So
fingers crossed. I mean, like I said, it's supposed to come out just middle February-ish. So hopefully there'll be some sort of some sort of announcement what can and can't do.
I'm trying to be positive, but I kind of got to see how it goes.
Would you consider, like, we've seen companies doing no crowd shows? Is that something you'd think, if it was safe to do so, would that be considered, or you just want to kind of, when you get out there, it has to be in front of a crowd?
I don't know. The way that this whole virus has been, I don't know what's safe and what isn't, to be honest. So if offers became available, they'd definitely all be considered.
Excellent. So as far as venues go, because I didn't ask that when I was doing Target Wrestling section, what venues have you enjoyed wrestling? Either intimate, biggest, crowd, just wild? What's been your favourite venues wrestling?
What was the home of Target Wrestling, which was called The Venue in Carlisle, that was that's one of my favourites. It was just, as I say, just like a rowdy crowd who were into everything, regardless of if it was somebody they hadn't seen before, a different style. They were kind of into everything, so that was that always made a fun crowd. If you can hear the noise on the first match, by the time it comes to your match, you're kind of ready for the reactions. I enjoyed the Jam House at Discovery as well. That was always a fun one. And like you mentioned Lockerbie earlier, there were never the biggest crowds at the Lockerbie shows in for Target, but it was one of those venues, really, really small. It was always a fun, more family orientated show. But I always enjoyed them shows. When you can peer through the curtain and kind of as a heel, know where you're going to aim your abuse. you kind of know you're in for a good one.
As soon as you said that, I thought, do you pick someone to kind of focus? Because I've seen heels do it, and it just makes me laugh every time, because it's so easy but so effective. If you pick a child or a parent, as soon as you go out and think, right, I'm going to just make sure you're my target through this whole night. Is that okay, you said, or are you just more of a case of just play it by ear when you get out there?
If you're not on first and you get to have a look, and you can kind of see which ones are making the noise, you kind of have. That's your easy target. I kind of just go out there, see how it goes. As you say, you kind of pick up who is making the noise, and you can kind of aim it that way. So.
Excellent. So I think we can wrap up there, because there's been, again, so many things that we've went through there. Before you go, because I'm actually going to make a concentrated effort to ask this question this year, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Probably an ankylosaurus.
Is that because your ankles themselves aren't what they used to be?
Yeah, bacon.
ankylosaurus.
I always remember as a kid, I always thought they looked quite cool. With the big tail, with the ball on the end, and in the hard shell.
I know we're on about now.
Always the one that I kind of thought was. It wasn't always an obvious choice for people's favorite dinosaurs, but I like them.
I know. I started the segment just out of, well, someone asked me to ask someone a question. This it was Kevin Williams asked me to ask people this, and I was like, yeah, that's a great idea. And what I really should have done was start looking at what dinosaurs were which, because people are throwing out ones that I'm going, you've made that one up. That one's not a real dinosaur. And then they sent me links afterwards going, see? All right, okay, jeez. Ankylosaurus, one of the big ball. Okay, so perfect. Well, thank you for joining me on the first 2021 edition of the SWN podcast. Where can people find you on social media?
At Shady Nattrass on Twitter, and if you're on Facebook, facebook.com/ShadyNattrass, and also at Wrestling Unity on Twitter and Project Wrestling Unity on Facebook.
Excellent. Well, thank you for. Oh.
And if you're on YouTube, give Pro Wrestling Is Real Life a check out. So
I'm sure we'll retweet it anyway. So I'm sure we'll throw in some links somewhere. People will be able to find it. But yeah, thank you very much for joining us.
No problem. Thanks for having me.